Good evening and welcome. My name is Karen Ball Pyatt, and I am the manager of the Grace Schmidt Room of Local History at the Kitchener Public Library. And I'm pleased to welcome you to our latest 85 Queen event entitled, What City Are We Building? Before we introduce tonight's guest, there's some housekeeping details. There will be a time for a question and answer period after the talk. And we invite you to use the Q&A feature located at the bottom of your screen. We will monitor questions, and as time permits, questions will be sent to Professor Haldenby to answer. Thank you for joining us this evening. We appreciate your time, patience, participation, and support of our online programs. Now for tonight's talk. First, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Professor Rick Haldenby. Rick is a very proud graduate of the University of Waterloo School of Architecture and was its director from 1988 to 2013. He is the founder of the University of Waterloo's Rome program, a teacher in the iconography theme area, and the recipient of the Distinguished Teacher Award. He's also been involved in archaeology work in Italy, Carthage, and Malta, and runs the Mid-Sized City Research Program. Rick's research interests include Mediterranean archaeology, design and management of historic landscapes and sites, and design in mid-sized cities, mid-century architecture, and community-university partnerships. Secondly, please join me in welcoming our speaker, Professor Rick Haldenby, and now the proverbial virtual floor is yours.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you very much. Here we go. I'm just trying to get my screen share up here, and we will get moving. Good evening, everyone, and thanks for joining us tonight. I'm humbled by the response that we've received to this initiative and the talk that is happening tonight to help us launch what is really, I think, an important contribution to the future of the city of Kitchener. I and a team of research assistants have put together a walking tour and guide to downtown Kitchener that focuses on the dramatically changing scene in the center of our city. The radical intensification, the increase in the size and number of new projects that now dominate the landscape and the skyline of the city of Kitchener. And the main reason for taking on this project was actually to pose the main question, which is, what kind of city are we building? Intensification in and of itself, is a principle that seems to be applying all across the province, at least, and of course through most North America. Core areas in cities all across North America are transforming themselves. But it is a particularly aggressive movement as it applies to downtown Kitchener. We're looking at a lot of new buildings, a dramatic increase in the number and size of the buildings that are being built here. And it is going to change our city, and it's going to change our city for a very long time. So my purpose here tonight is both to talk about the general questions related to the intensification of the Kitchener core, but also to introduce you to the specific initiative that we've taken, and which will appear as both a published document in the next week or so, and also as a website that will be a growing, changing, and live correlative to the document that we're going to be making available. This document will be available through the city, through the public library, through the art gallery, through businesses in the downtown core, and it will also be available for download from the website. I want to say that the undertaking has been intense. when it the idea first came up, I thought it would be a pretty simple matter to just publish a map with a few dots on it that would show people where the major construction sites were in the downtown core of the city. But it worked out very differently. The project is called Intense City. It's a walking tour and guide to the changing urban landscape in downtown Kitchener. This enterprise was conceived, designed and produced by a small team of people. It was truly inspired by Susan Burke of the Architectural Conservancy of Ontario, North Waterloo Region Branch, when she and I sat on her front porch before Christmas and talked about some projects that the education arm of ACO North Waterloo might do. And she actually suggested this. And it is interesting, coming from the Architectural Conservancy, that we will be that the project focuses primarily on contemporary construction. But of course, the point is that it focuses on contemporary construction and in respect of what effect that construction is going to have on the future heritage of downtown Kitchener. And I was blessed after Christmas to receive federal government funding through the University of Waterloo to hire two full-time research assistants. And the lion's share of the credit for the successes of this project have to go to Ms. Isabella Supa, who is a fourth year architecture student at the University of Waterloo, who has been working on this project pretty much continuously for the last 3 months. Isabella is responsible for the design, is responsible for the graphic communication and the infographics in the document and eventually on the website. Her dedication to this has just been extraordinary, and her insights and energy were utterly indispensable. She's been supported by Mazzoliana Bonina, who is a second year student at the University of Waterloo School of Architecture. Uliana has not been working primarily on the Kitchener project. She's been working on some other projects, including work on the Northdale area in Waterloo and comparing the urban situation relating to the university development around it and comparing that to other cities of similar size and universities of similar size, too, with some very revealing results, which we will disseminate. Uliana also completed an extraordinary project which took the famous 1915 Busy Berlin map, which mapped out all of the industrial buildings in downtown Kitchener and documented which of those buildings still exist and which of those buildings have been demolished. She's produced a beautiful, beautiful map of that, which will also become available. We acknowledge the support of Architectural Conservancy on Ontario North Waterloo Region Branch, Waterloo Architecture, and the University of Waterloo. We still are building Waterloo Region, the entity that was created in 2014 to carry on the Building Waterloo Region exhibitions. This will be revived and re-enlivened, and we are extremely grateful to the Kitchener Public Library for giving us the platform tonight and for supporting this initiative, and Kitchener Waterloo Art Gallery that also has been so committed to the health and vitality and cultural and energy in the Kitchener core. Well, I just put the 1875 map of downtown Kitchener, King and Queen, just to remind us all where this starts. I mean, it starts at the Joseph Schneider House, of course, but this is what downtown Kitchener looked like in 1875. I'm not even sure I could tell you that any of the buildings that are pictured in this map still exists, but it does at least tell us where the layering of the downtown core starts. This is the point of departure, and from here is where the city grows. It's also worth pointing out by way of background that reminding everyone that the notion that Kitchener and Waterloo region are somehow rural municipalities and small cities is not true anymore. We are a city on the edge of being a metropolitan area in its own right. The Kitchener Census District is the 10th largest in Canada. We are in the top 10. There is some debate about which is the fastest growing metropolitan area in Canada, but there is no debate that we are no lower than second. We are the 8th and the smallest municipality in Canada to install a rail-based public transit system with the ION system. At some point, that actually qualifies for courageous, even visionary. Of course, this region is blessed with a deep tradition of technical, industrial, economic, and I should say environmental innovation, educational innovation. There is something in the area that promotes reflection and a kind of pragmatic visionary quality that has served the health and prosperity and vitality of the municipalities in Waterloo region very, very well over time. And as other municipalities suffered great economic decline and the accompanying social and other problems, and our area has managed to reinvent itself quite effectively over its whole history. And of course, part of the reason and both the reason and the expression of this innovation is to be found in the various infrastructures that were built very aggressively after the Second World War. Most obviously, of course, the educational infrastructure, three post-secondary educational institutions, a whole plethora of new high schools. There was one high school, public high school in Waterloo, in Kitchener-Waterloo in 1950. By 1972, there were 8. And now there are 9. Transportation infrastructure, of course, after the war came the 401, the Conestoga Parkway. There was obviously a tailing off of the traditional transportation infrastructure, particularly rail, and a vast increase in the amount of road traffic, and the building of roads was extraordinary. But here we are today. And what our guide tries to do is not only give you a route to walk by some 20 of the current construction sites that are active in the downtown core today, but it also attempts to give you a background to how we got to where we are in the terms of the layering and, as it were, stratigraphy of the downtown core of Kitchener in the post-war period. It does not go back into the first three-quarters century of the history of the city. It stays rigorously in the post-war period. But it's simply incredible to walk around today. I happen to live right in the center of the city. I live on Victoria Park. Walk out on the front porch and look at construction cranes, look at high-rise buildings that are growing literally by the day right in front of me. And this image was taken from the railway tracks at Park, where the tracks cross, and you see this kind of panorama of construction cranes and of course high-rise buildings that are appearing all through the downtown core. So our guide is an attempt to give every citizen in Kitchener and Waterloo and Cambridge and anywhere else where there's interest a chance to measure out with their eyes and their feet the changes that are underway, physical changes that are underway in the core, and then to give some background and insight into the processes into which these changes fit and to pose some questions about what the implication of change actually is. So here it is. This is the actual guide. These are the top is the front and the bottom is the back. So on the in the front of the document, you have covers and credits. And then in the middle there, you have a walking tour through downtown Kitchener, which with each of the construction sites identified by a number, and then a matrix, which actually shows you what the buildings are supposed to look like when they're finished. These are renderings of the buildings that are included in the document. And for each of those buildings, you get the title of the development, you get the address of the development, you get the name of the developer, you get the name of the architect, you get the number of stories, the number of units or employees that are going to be in the building, and then you get the state of whether it's proposed, under construction, or completed, and what the funding is, whether it's public development or private commercial development. On the other side of the document, you have a text, Intensity, the Kitchener Core in 2021, that describes the present situation in general terms and poses some questions to anyone who's going to have a look at all of these sites. At the other end, we have some infographics that try to communicate some salient facts about the present situation. And I'll come back to these in when I'm talking later. And in between, there are four panels that divide the history of the Kitchener Core since the Second World War into four periods. Kitchener Modern, that is the period immediately after the war, that corresponds to the baby boom and a little bit more, and the modernization of the city. The failed dream of a renewed core, which is a 7-year period in which three huge projects were undertaken, Market Square, King Center, and the center in the square, Mackenzie King Square, which is where the art gallery and the center in the square are now. Then there is a period called postmodern Kitchener, which is a kind of intermezzo where there is a different kind of development. Each of these periods shows different types of development. And our idea, of course, is that as you walk around, you can understand the layering of the city through the kinds of buildings that were built during these four phases. And then the last of these four, we've called from City Hall to Google. That is, from the moment that Kitchener City Hall opened until the time that the present boom in construction took place. The divisions, I hope, will become clearer as I move forward through this talk. But this is the document. It's an accordion fold. You can fold it out. If it's in your pocket, you can carry it around. It's got a whole lot of information in it. You can see how we tried to keep the text compact. We didn't list every building that was built in the four historic phases we talked about. We're just trying to show that the buildings that are either most interesting or most typical of the period. And then there's a little text that describes the period, and I'll just go through these quickly. So Kitchener Modern, the first period at which we looked, takes us from the end of the Second World War up to 1968 to the beginning of the project for the destruction of the old City Hall and the building of Market Square. We could have listed far more buildings because it was a dramatic period of transformation. The region all in all was changing, but downtown Kitchener particularly underwent a transformation. It is the period in which they built the first high-rise apartment buildings, they built the first high-rise office buildings, and they transformed public institutions, new hotels were built, new banks. It was a very, very, very dramatic, modernization of the city, and it was aggressively modern. The style of the new buildings is very much in keeping with the style of the new international style of modernism that was imported from Europe after the Second World War and distributed across North America. Kitchener particularly was a very enthusiastic adherent to modern style. And of course I have speculated in other places that this has to do with the dominance of industrial architecture, which in its own right was the provocation for European modernism. And with some irony, North American industrial architecture stimulates European modern architecture, and then European modern architecture is re-imported into North America after the Second World War and becomes the so-called, an effective official style of architecture in North America. And the modern period in Kitchener is remarkably productive and remarkably high quality architecture. We forget this often. And it's also worth noting that during this period, there were no fewer than 7 local architectural firms practicing at an extremely high level of quality, producing excellent buildings, sometimes again aggressively in the new style of architecture, and sometimes practicing an architecture that is trying to be simultaneously sensitive to history and also at embodying the values and standards of the modernists. And Kitchener Public Library in its original state is a perfect example of that. Designed by Barnett and Reeder, the most important local firm, if only judged by the number of projects they did. We can debate whether they were whether Carl Reeder was the greatest architect of the group, but you can't debate the number of projects that Barnett and Reeder did. Staggering number. Kitchener Public Library was a beautiful building. It invokes medieval images in pointed arches and in stonework, but no one would mistake it for anything but a modern building with its giant glazed surfaces, its luminous ceilings. It was unequivocally modern, but a very, very good index of the quality of architecture that was executed in those days. This is Bruce Etherington's brilliant Toronto Dominion Bank branch at the corner of King and Frederick. It is one of the most extraordinary pieces of modernism in Canada, done by the architect for the Toronto Dominion Bank. It's one of the relatively few buildings in Kitchener, Waterloo, Cambridge that were built in this Kitchener modern era, one of the few buildings that wasn't done by a local architect. This is a fantastic piece of bank architecture, stands on a corner like banks are supposed to do in Ontario, not a straight line in the building. It invokes, again, history by the use of stone, invoking bronze, invoking and green marble. It's just such a wonderful piece of modern architecture. And now, of course, it's Krabby Joe's. Just down the street, Barnett and Reeder, in effect, respond to the TD Bank or the Bank of Nova Scotia, which in effect uses the same material, except the bronze is real. Whereas on the TD Bank, the bronze is actually aluminum painted to look like bronze. Here, those grills are bronze, and the building has a kind of classical, much more classical feel looking at the cornice. And this is, but again, unequivocally modern. The crest is modern. It's a absolutely beautiful piece of a kind of liminal historicism, modernism that speaks so highly of the quality of design. Schneider, Huguette, and March designed the Waterloo County Courthouse, the not original, but the post-war Waterloo County Courthouse, a fantastic piece of modernism with this beautiful thin-shelled concrete canopy sneaking out from underneath the overhang of this remarkable boomerang of a building. I have to say, I came to Kitchener in 1968 and was trying to get up to the University of Waterloo. We drove up Weber Street and I saw this building. I was still in high school. Saw this building. I told the guys in the car we had to stop because I had to, what the heck is this? And then I'm not going to show you 100 buildings from that period, but I couldn't fail to show you this marvelous rendering that my friends at Perimeter Development found when they bought this building and found the original architect's perspective rolled up in a tube in the basement. This building was the first office building. There were several other office buildings, 50 Queen and other buildings built after it in downtown Kitchener as the idea of the Kitchener core was developing. But this one not only was the first office tower in Kitchener, it's also the first office tower designed by Webb and Menkes, which became Webb, Zarafa, Menkes, and Hausden, which is a firm that has designed literally hundreds of office towers all around the world. Now, this was their very first, in 1962. Now, this is 305 King Street. If you go by it today, it looks like this. I mean, it's always fun to look at the architect's rendering, what they imagined their building was going to look like, and then what the building actually looks like. I mentioned transportation infrastructure, and I can never fail to give a lecture about the history of Waterloo Region without showing the picture of the 401 being bushwhacked through across the agricultural land and through the woodlots of Southern Ontario. It's so hard for people to imagine Ontario without the 401. So I always like to show a picture of the beginnings of the 401 and reminding people that the 401 arrived at Kitchener in 1962, the same year 305 King Street opened, this same year that the Waterloo County Courthouse opened. I mean, it's an extremely poignant transition, point of transition in the history of our city. And of course, at the same time, they're building the addition to St. Mary's Hospital, and the suburbs are just sprawling out from the center. Of course, still fairly limited. And as you can see from this aerial photograph, post-war housing was in the first instance extremely modest. And that was one of the characteristics of the original post-war suburbs, was the modesty of the residential architecture. There was a sense of restraint that probably grew naturally out of the response to the war. But that sense of restraint seems to dissolve when it turns out that the expressway, like the Spadina Expressway in Toronto, was going to be connected to the development of these massive regional shopping malls, Fairview Mall and Conestoga Mall at the north and south ends of the parkway. This, of course, is the death knell of the traditional downtown core. Sprawling suburbs don't necessarily kill the core, but regional shopping malls do. And that's a demonstrable historic fact. So this is Fairview Mall on opening night, you know, when cars were the size of buildings and Simpson Sears was a flagship store with its beautiful precast scalloped facade. Now, concealed and demolished by a pseudo-industrial facade, as if someone was building an industrial building on the site, not a retail shopping site. And the response in the downtown is, of course, to try to accommodate the automobile, because suburban shopping malls just created vast seas of parking, as we just saw. So, of course, one of the most remarkable projects in downtown Kitchener was the Duke Street parking garage by McCarter and Hatchborn, and with its phenomenal elliptic ramp, just one of the most extraordinary pieces of architectural sculpture that we've ever seen. It's just an incredible thing. And the idea of cars kind of making their way up this thing and wondering what the reinforcing steel looks like that makes this all stand up. Fantastic, fantastic image of the future of downtown Kitchener, where it could as easily bring a car as you could to a parking lot of a suburban shopping mall. And of course, no, it's a fail. Doesn't happen that way. And at the time in the mid 60s, this was the vision of the future of downtown Kitchener. Demolish the entire historic fabric of the city, make a one-way street system, build a lot of abstract architectural objects on a podium that has parking underneath it, and this sort of amorphous semi-green public space that meanders aimlessly through amongst these. They're not really towers. I mean, the image of the building is not a tower, but it is an image of erasure, complete historic erasure and modernization as an exclusive and unilateral program that delivers a kind of apocalyptic completeness to the center of a city. Well, we tried and it didn't really work. But we didn't actually try to do what the plan in 1965 proposed. Instead, no, public agencies and private developers assembled properties, demolished the existing buildings on the sites, and built three huge, completely inward-looking complexes, two commercial and one cultural. King Center, Market Square, and Center in the Square don't share functions, but they do share properties. That is to say, they do share characteristics. And those characteristics are huge land assembly, massive demolitions, the creation of these giant structures that are completely inward looking. And as it says in the guide, in a fit of cynicism, you know, they survived only long enough to suck the life out of the city and then failed. And let us just say that they are not alone in this respect in Ontario. In the previous research project, we studied the 19 urban shopping malls that were built in middle-sized cities across Ontario, and every one of them failed. Peterborough, Brantford, you name it, they failed. And it, in retrospect, it's completely obvious that they're going to fail, and that in failing, they did huge damage. But at the time, this was regarded as the way that the downtown core could respond to the regional shopping malls at the border of the city, at the edge of the city. Well, this walking tour simply takes you through this level where there's a brief text that describes what happened as we develop the website that will go along with this guide. There will be more detail about what actually happened in these cases, and other sources and et cetera will be listed. The losses are pretty dramatic. I mean, it's almost impossible to conceive today that they tore this down. I mean, this is a dignified piece of civic architecture. It's not the finest piece of neoclassicism in Canada, but it's nowhere near the worst. I mean, it's a really fine building. Fortunately, some crazy people labeled all the parts to the clock tower and stored them in a yard somewhere. Compliments to the city of Kitchener for doing that, and then compliments to them for re-erecting it in Victoria Park. Well, here's what we got. We tore down that building. We tore down the old market building, And we let Oxley Developments build an office tower in for a city hall. I mean, give me a break is all I can say. And one of the worst shopping, urban shopping malls ever created. I mean, those of us who were around at the time that opened could not believe that the principal entrance to the shopping mall was set so far back from the street and effectively hidden by these weird diagonal stairs that took you up to a terrace that didn't had nothing on it. Like, I don't know what to say. Who thought this was a good idea? Obviously, the civic fathers of the time, largely made up of people who were involved in the real estate industry, thought it was a great idea. Well, then they had another idea. This is Mackenzie King Square. This is what you probably recognize. The very bottom of this picture, there's the bottom center is the outline of Kitchener Public Library. And then this is what was supposed to happen. There's the federal building there, and then there's the theater, and then miraculously Hamilton City Hall appears in this picture. And I don't know exactly what they thought that was going to be or what this podium is, but that was the vision. They tore down some of the most beautiful houses along Queen Street, beautiful old mansion, Victorian houses, and this was the vision. Well, if the vision was a little bit flawed, the reality is actually probably worse. And I'm a huge admirer of the Kitchener-Waterloo Art Gallery. I'm a huge admirer of the Center in the Square for its programming and for its efforts to promote culture and entertainment in the region. But oh my goodness. As architecture, as civic architecture, as a nucleus for what should be the cultural zone of the city, I mean, there is just no way you can say anything about these that isn't skeptical. I don't like saying that these three great redevelopment projects were all fails, but two of them are clearly failed by their own criteria, and the third one is equivocal at this point, and we need to do something about it, and everyone in Kitchener knows that we need to do something about it. Postmodern Kitchener from 75 to 93, it's an almost 20-year period, and there are projects, and they're quite large, but the big difference, as you can even see from this plan, is that they no longer rely on massive land assemblies and huge demolition efforts. Demolition is gone, massive land assembly is gone, and there is a more incremental approach, a different scale. I mean, there are some ambitious projects. The other thing that comes quite clear in this phase is looking at number 23 and number 24 here. These are reuses of historic buildings, the Button Factory and the CIBC branch at King and Queen. And that is a landmark. I mean, let's face it, it's a point of inflection where we start to not demolish buildings. And as someone who was involved directly in the fight to save the Button Factory, I speak with some passion and conviction about this. To be fair to the developer, they were never going to tear down the original Button Factory. They wanted to tear down the early addition to it, but we worked out a deal where they didn't. And this is a big point it is a point of inflection in the history of our downtown core. Those two projects represent a major point of inflection. The region built their headquarters, the project at Frederick and Weber gets built, the Canada Trust Tower gets built, the Transit Center gets built, and the amazing TD Bank at King and Francis, the granite cenotaph there is an amazing thing. But of course, it uses traditional materials. Even the transit building kind of takes on a postmodern strangely, eerily postmodern air. It is a point of inflection. It's a point of change. And so here, Canada Trust, I'll spare you the normal nickname. And then, of course, the so-called Galleria, the diagonal office building, and the regional headquarters, another Reeder, Hyman, and Lavin project. And here it is, the Button Factory, the Bread and Roses Housing Co-op. And to look at it today, it's just a normal part of the urban landscape. But please, as you walk around and walk past it, think of what it actually represents in the history of our city, the preservation of the history of our city. And it was not a foregone conclusion, as you can understand when you understand the layering of the downtown core. And then, of course, the momentous period from the moment of Kitchener City Hall, the national design competition that attracted the most extraordinary young talent across the country, when you realize that of the finalists in the Kitchener City Hall competition, 4 out of the 5 were very young architects who'd never actually done a project. The firm that won, Kubar Payne McKinnon Bloomberg, was a very experienced firm, but this was their first civic building. Kitchener has a way of attracting that, the first of something. And it was a massively successful project. Now, it was championed as a way of revitalizing the downtown core. And to be honest, we point this out in the text, it didn't happen overnight. In fact, it didn't happen all that quickly at all, but it started. And it's easy to show that it started there. And gradually after the mid-1990s, things start to change. And you have a variety of development that goes on. And just from this map alone, you can see the density of the development and the dispersal of the development. And of course, the hatched buildings are the ones that reuse existing buildings in their design. So the fact is, there comes to be a balanced situation, balanced in terms of dispersal, balanced in terms of typology, balanced in terms of preservation and new construction. Very healthy system. City Hall, I always look at this. This is the first sketch that the architect Bruce Kubar did of Kitchener City Hall. I'm just astonished. I can't believe that you can build your very first sketch, but that's what they did. And I don't need to tell you that whatever else one can say about it, it has been a very successful building. And of course, some of its success depends on the energy and efforts that have been put into programming events around it, but it's been a huge success as an image and generator for the life of the center of the city. But, you know, there are wonderful projects. And again, the renovation of Kitchener Public Library, and it is worth remembering that the Kitchener Public Library considered tearing down the building, existing building. They considered relocating the whole library somewhere else. And my compliments to all of those involved in the project, but particularly Levitt Goodman, Janet Levitt, I'm a great admirer of her, the architect Janet Levitt. And she wrote a brilliant report and study that showed that you could actually save money by preserving the building, because we're so often told it costs money to preserve buildings, which is kind of counterintuitive. But anyway, I'm not here to debate that tonight. But this building is brilliant, and I'm sure our friends from the library can tell you what a success it's been. And then you get, of course, this reuse of industrial buildings for condominia. This is the Arrow Shirt Factory. Of course, this is Kaufman Rubber and designed by the most important industrial architect of all time, of ever in the world, Albert Kahn. Here, quadrangle renovates the Coffin rubber plant into a condo. Raw Architects renovates the Lang Tannery into the tannery, the high-tech hub generator that attracts Google from the North Campus in Waterloo into downtown Kitchener. And if the City Hall didn't change the direction of downtown Kitchener, certainly Google did. And here is the model we built back in 2014 of the Google project for the Bright Up block, which of course is another extremely important project in the history of downtown Kitchener. The other point of inflection in all of this, of course, is the ION and the implementation of light rail transit, which has an absolutely remarkable effect on the real estate market in Waterloo region, and points to a very simple principle that when done properly and judiciously, public investment can induce private investment. And I think it's perfectly clear that that's what is happening here. And here you have that relationship stated in no uncertain terms, the ION under construction and the Google project under construction in the background. I mean, it's a pretty clear relationship. Well, and that brings us to the threshold of the situation we're in today. And we are in a situation dominated by changing technologies, not just tech companies moving to the downtown core of Kitchener, but changing technologies of all kinds, changing urban values, changing cities. Certainly the Places to Grow Act passed by the provincial government in 2005, now 16 years ago, changed values and changed cities and loosed some problems that we're going to have to continue to deal with. But there is no question that Places to Grow changed the way cities grow and promoted intensification. The industrial landscape has obviously changed. We're not, these factories are no longer in the business of manufacturing them, in the business of housing people and housing creative industries, new enterprises. Transportation, there is a revolution in transportation going on, and it's about electric cars, it's about public transit, it's about self-driving cars. I mean, there is no way you can future-proof yourself right now. We don't know exactly what the future of transportation is. But in intensifying cities, we also understand that the most important mode of transit in an intensified city is pedestrian transit, is people walking, cycling and walking. And to its credit, the city of Kitchener is looking at cycling seriously. I think that one of the sad things about the development of the ION is that they didn't follow the principle that light rail should have built into the project an enhancement of all aspects of public space that are adjacent to and connected with the light rail transit system to actually enhance pedestrian and cycling experience, which it clearly doesn't. Urban intensification is a fact. The whole question of private versus public space, the amount of private space is being reduced, and people are living in, once again, in more constricted spaces. So obviously there's a corollary to how we need to handle public space. The whole question of mixed use is up for debate right now. We have developers, some of whom may be with us tonight, who have spoken quite clearly about the problems with the kind of nostrum that we've had since the 1970s, that the ground floor of developments in cities should be retail. Well, retail isn't what retail was. And so this is a question we're going to have to address: retail, entertainment, and creative spaces. I mean, the only retail that seems to be doing really, really well in downtown Kitchener now is pot shops, of which we seem to have a plethora. I have no idea how all these pot shops can survive, but that maybe we're just all going to be stoned all the time. And of course, in dealing with our present situation, we have to look at cultural diversity. The city does not belong to one group. The city belongs to everybody. And we have to make sure that public space is designed in such a way and that it reflects that. And of course, we have to compensate for historical injustice. And I mean, sitting in the middle of the Haldenby tract, we've got to face the music that history is not on our side in this respect. In the guidebook, what you will see is at the bottom of the page of the history, there is a timeline that Isabella designed. I think it's very lovely. It just has the most important information. KPL is built, the plan for downtown Kitchener, the construction of the 401, the construction of the Conestoga Parkway, the construction of the GO, the coming of GO, and the coming of the ION, and then a series of legislative landmarks and physical landmarks, Kitchener City Hall, the places to grow. 1 year after Places to Grow, the City of Kitchener establishes its Economic Development Fund. And of course, another salient point is in the beginning of 2019, exemption ends for development charges on downtown development. That is to say, the exemption is over, so the charges have to be paid, which of course was one of the efficient causes of the development boom that we're in the throes of right now. So here's the number. From 1993 to 2018, there were 24 major projects built in downtown Kitchener. 24 major projects. From 2019 to today, there are 26 major projects in downtown Kitchener. 25 years now. It's actually staggering. And to digest this is almost impossible. An earlier research assistant, this is not Isabella and Uliana, but someone who worked on this last year, I had him do these 3D drawings that show the projects that were built in downtown Kitchener between 1993 and 2018. And you can see them all here. And here's what's going on right now. It's interesting to look at them. There are some clusters, especially at the west end of the drawing by Victoria Street and the railway tracks, the Victoria Street cluster and the Station Park cluster. Most of the other ones are individual buildings. Some of them are very high. Some of them are more accommodated. Regulated into the scale of the existing city. But a couple of things that are made clear by this drawing. Number one, the projects are fairly widely distributed. And there's a lot of the existing city that is preserved. And one of the most important things in my mind is that we're not erasing the city, that the layering and one of the main points of this document was to show that the layering is there. You actually see the layers of the history of the city, and you can see it embodied in the buildings that are still there today. And that is a mark of a healthy city. Going in and bulldozing whole quarters of the city, which we did in Kitchener back when, and which is being done in cities very close to us, like touching us, this is problematic. And I think And I've actually complimented the planning staff in the city of Kitchener and the development community in Kitchener that there is a sense of layer, a sense of history, a sense of continuity, and a sense of multiple presences and simultaneous presences that are still present, still to be seen, still to be felt, even though there is an unprecedented amount of new construction that's going on. And here are the two phases juxtaposed. It's very interesting to compare these two things. Well, in our guidebook, we don't reproduce the color imagery of these different buildings. We give a kind of blue tone to everything, but you can see the pictures of the buildings as they are supposed to be. These are the four major commercial projects. In the core, the Gowling's building is finished and almost, I'm not sure that it's open yet. The Bright Up block across from the Google project is under construction. The building on the former Mayfair Hotel site is about to be opened, and the Glove Box project up on Victoria Street is very much under construction. So as you walk around and look at these construction sites, you can keep in mind that this is what we were told the buildings would look like. And I have to say that the two that are basically complete from this group actually look quite a bit like what the representation of them. Here are some of the sort of more medium density projects that are under construction in downtown Kitchener now. I'm not going to go through them all. They're fairly typical projects, although, you know, there's some interesting design aspects of some of them. And the one in the upper right, of course, is on Queen Street and through negotiation preserved two historic buildings in front and built this pretty massive slab block in behind. I think it's serious architecture. It's not, you know, it's not as ambitious as the public projects that we've designed in Kitchener City Hall, among them the courthouse, etc. But they're respectable projects. And then we get into the higher stuff. This is the one of the iterations of Station Park. I think these are the images from the previous developer. They're the new developer has come in now and taken on the project. It's and the first two towers are under construction, and the other ones will go up afterwards. And then there are the three towers at 100 Victoria behind the Glove Box. And then you see here at the upper left, Charlie West on the right-hand side, DTK, which is the highest of all the towers up to now, at the corner of Duke and Frederick, across from the courthouse. Massive project. And of course, here are the two more recently proposed. The tower at 20 Queen Street, which is on the right, which has a historic building kind of trapped underneath it. And then the 44-story tower proposed at Francis and Charles, with the towering over the previous highest condo tower at the corner of King and Victoria, the black building at the corner of King and Victoria. So in your little guidebook, you'll be able to see there is a graphic that shows you the height of the existing buildings in the city, and then the new buildings ramping up and up and up. 34 is Charlie West, 39 is DTK, and 44 is, 31 is Charlie West. 34, I think, is the Queen Street building. 39 is DTK and 44 is the corner of Frederick and Francis and Charles. So literally three times as high as the previous high buildings. Now these are just some images of it, the whole process underway. And I'm not showing them because this is what the place looks like now. This is what Charlie West looked like, not in the middle of last winter, but the winter before, if I'm not mistaken. And I like this because it connects the new construction with the Ion. This is a more recent picture taken from the tannery, looking at the towers on Victoria Street, building behind the tannery. In the guidebook, it makes the point that these buildings are changing the perception of public space in downtown Kitchener. It changes your experience of the street. It changes your experience of the open spaces of the city. And these photographs are really meant to kind of capture that and entice you to take this walk and experience what this change actually means. So here's 305, the first office tower in downtown Kitchener, and next door, the Gowlings building, which they're calling a tower, but it's not actually got the proportions of a tower, but it's a very, very high-end office space, one really advanced, high-quality office space in downtown Kitchener, and a really important step in the future of the downtown core. And then looking the other way down past City Hall, you see the project on the site of the Mayfair Hotel, you see a preserved historic building, and then you see this huge long facade that's developing, changing, really changing the scale of King Street and the sense of enclosure that this is going to be a very delicate operation. If this facade is done well, this could be a very important and positive part of the downtown core. If it's not done well, then look out. This could become quite oppressive. This is DTK. This is Charlie West at the corner of Charles and Gockel, across from 44 Gockel, the former post office. It's a pretty good building, all in all, I've got to say. Compliments to the developer and the architect. They've handled the problem of the above ground parking with a certain delicacy, which is rare in this typology. So good. And then of course it truly dominates the clock tower common of Victoria Park. And so here you are standing by the clock tower and looking past the clock tower to the tower of City Hall and to the tower of Charlie West. It changes the game. It changes the proportion. It makes high things look low. I mean, if you think back to when the pharmacy school was built and the tower of the pharmacy school was a tower. And then across the street, the developer built that massive black condo project, which then made the pharmacy school look small. And this is the kind of dynamic that's happening. And so one of our goals in suggesting that people take this walk, you can get on the loop wherever you get on the loop, but it is a loop, and take the walk around. And as we said, measure it out with your feet, measure it out with your eyes. This is the view from my front porch. I've watched Charlie go up every morning, go out and look at how tall he is. In the end, I'm not against it. I'm not trying to suggest that it's the wrong thing to happen. I mean, you know, the most famous instance of relationship between high-rise buildings and public space of Central Park in New York, which is ringed by relatively high buildings, and they actually create the ambience of the park. There is a certain virtue in having high density buildings near important public open spaces, especially when the size of the units in which people live is so small. And in this case, it's there's nothing really bad about this. It's just we need to think about what we're doing, and we need to make sure that it doesn't end up being a case where these buildings completely overwhelm the public space and completely overwhelm your experience of open space in the downtown core. Yes, the center of my world is my front porch. I mean, there's no question about that. This is the view across the lake to the 100 Victoria project in the morning. It's a glistening golden city. So let's just finish up by looking at a couple of things. Number one, in the period between 1993 and 2017, 2018, of the 24 projects, 11 were public, 11 were private, and 2 were public-private partnerships. In the 26 projects we've got going up right now, 24 are private and 2 are public. The transportation hub and the new police station in the former courthouse on Frederick Street. That's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. 3,000 units, minimum 3,000 units, will more than double the population of the core. More than double the population of the core. And the question immediately comes up, people who are living in very small units are going to need a living room. The core has to become a public jewel, a place that brings life and attraction to people. 2,700 new jobs, 19 new buildings, 6 more proposed, 650,000 square feet of office space. We've watched public investment lead to private investment. We watched the development boom that was precipitated by the announcement of the end of the exemption from development charges, which meant that we got $1.3 billion invested for a $48 million reduction in fees. But of course, we're adding 3,000 units in the core, and we need 9,000 affordable housing units. And that just puts the problem in some scale. And pointing this out, that the average price of a unit in the core in 2016 was $369,000, it's now $502,000. Change is happening at a breakneck pace in the region. Change could lead to marvelous new spaces and vistas in our cities, or it could lead to soulless urban wastelands of towering condos jammed together with few public spaces that invite people to pause and linger. That's Ken Greenberg, quoted by Catherine Thompson in The Record 2 years ago. And this is a presentation that's going to happen tomorrow in my design studio. I'm running a design studio at the School of Architecture, as some of you may know, reading The Record, Terry Bender's article in The Record, that I have 16 students who are looking at the problem of intensification in Kitchener and Waterloo, primarily Kitchener, I should say. And one of our thesis students, Nicole Rack, is going to present her work on condos and culture. And this is a beautiful, informal installation from Toronto called Condos Kill Community. And we have to accept that that's one way of understanding the situation, and at least find a way to respond to the challenge. And so Nicole tomorrow is going to talk about condos and culture, which of course is what we need to talk about. I'm not going to say any more about Places to Grow. Places to Grow is a revolutionary, this is the first really serious piece of legislation to try to regulate the development industry in a generation, and I better say nothing about it more because it just makes me mad. Not that we did it, but that the present government doesn't seem to really understand it. And we need collaboration between municipal agencies, private agencies. We need to coordinate and focus our efforts. We need to see that public investment generated private investment. And in the course of time now, we've got to, having created all this new development and having brought all these people to the center of the city. And I mean, we haven't brought them yet. These projects are all going to open in the next 2 years and there's going to be 8,000 more people in the core. This is the transit hub. I only want to say that there are efforts, and I want to compliment the city of Kitchener and the region for trying to do things. The fountain in Victoria Park, Bulbison Green in the Queen Street revitalization. I'm not so sure I think this is great, but it's an attempt. Paint the street. I'll just do a shout out to another one of my thesis students, Violeta Mikhailova, who is doing work on the whole question of exhibition space and cultural space and public space in the city. And she's also presenting at our little symposium tomorrow. We've worked with the art gallery in Kitchener to try to reimagine the civic district and the park in the civic district and to look at the future of and reimagine the future of a cultural site in downtown Kitchener. I don't even need to talk about this picture. Increasing density, reduction in the amount and quality of private space requires expansion and enhancement of public space, green space and resources for cultural recreation, leisure and the spirit. Simple. Affordable housing must be built as people are pushed out by the juggernaut of new development. We have to find the missing middle, the middle kind of middle height, middle cost, middle, the missing middle. Urban space should enhance the pedestrian experience and give it priority over all other modes of travel. Respect existing resources. What's left of heritage architecture in the downtown must be preserved. Modern buildings, that is post-war buildings, renewed, stable neighborhoods protected. The new center of gravity in downtown is the intersection of King and Victoria. That area needs a beautiful public focal point. Use the power of the Planning Act to establish a design review. And ladies and gentlemen, here's the walk. Go on it.
As Rick mentioned, the walking guide will be available at City Hall, at the Kitchener Public Library, and at downtown BIA members. And the website will be developed soon, and that'll become online, so keep watch out for that. And just a shameless plug for the Gray Schmidt Room. I invite you to watch, if you're a fan of local history or heritage, take time to check out our new digital platform, History in the Making. We've uploaded all of our photographs, we're uploading oral histories, other digital objects there for everyone to enjoy. And I invite you to watch social media and the library's website for details on our upcoming 85 Queen Street events. And we hope to see you again soon.